So good morning, organizer, and good morning, participant. Are you hearing me? Is my voice audible? So shall we start the session? So welcome you all for this 5 days FTP on deep neural networks and expert system. Today is the fourth day. As scheduled, today's topic is design of fuzzy expert system. I am here to discuss about how to design a expert system with the help of the concept fuzzy logic. So what is an expert system? If you develop any algorithm for making a machine to understand the environment so that the machine can work as an autonomous system, then without the intervention of human being, the machine can work on their own and take decision on their own depending on the situation and depending on the context. That kind of machine is treated as a machine in the form of expert system. How that expert system can be designed? There are enormous methods are available for designing such expert system. Here, I am going to talk about the concept of fuzzy for designing the expert system. Let me go into the topic. What is mean by decision making? So what is the requirement of an expert system? Without the intervention of human being, the system has to take an action so that the problem at that particular context will be rectified. So in general, what is decision making? So it is an action of ones based on their intention to get the desired outcome. Say, for example, this kind of decision making process is there in our day-to-day life, starting from taking food. So it is the action of this person to decide what to eat, provided he will be given two alternatives. That is, if anyone is provided with more than one alternative, then it is the objective of that person to decide what to take. Even though it is objective of the person, if that objective is vary from person to person, if these two item is given to you, means you will decide something, I may decide something, and someone may decide something among the two alternatives provided. So even though it is the objective of the individual, on the whole, it is treated as it is the subjective form. Likewise, look at the second one. A person is provided with many gadgets, model, that is mobile models, and he is in a position to choose a particular model. That is, he has to decide which model suits his requirement. So he has many parameters inside him to analyze the model and to come to a definite conclusion to choose the model that suits his requirement. So here also, the decision-making process is objective with respect to a person, but subjective with respect to overall audience or overall participant in the decision making process. Likewise, the decision making process is everywhere in our day to day life, starting from the way in which we are going to choose our course, the way in which we are going to study the concept. So everything is a decision making process, and remember, in this decision making process you are provided with many alternatives and you have to choose one thing based on the suitability or based on your requirement. But there some confusion arises. That's the idea here. What kind of confusion arises? If you look at many alternatives, you may fed up with the alternatives that it seems that all the alternatives are suitable to you. That is, you may get into stuck with some kind of confusion what to choose and what to omit. Because on the first process of selecting something, you feel that both are seems to be good or both are seems to be one and the same. In such situation, you are facing some kind of dilemma to choose a particular alternative. So we are going to talk about that dilemma, that confuse, that uncertain situation only in the concept of fuzzy logic. Participants, I hope you understand the idea. So whenever you are provided with some set of objects or some set of events and you are asked to decide one particular event, but while doing so, you will face with some kind of confusions because all the objects as well as all the events are one and seems to be one and the same for you, so that you cannot take a concrete decision. But anyhow, you have to make a decision. Finally, you are making a decision. In what way you are making a decision and what is the speciality of the human being to make such a decision? Even if a person chooses a wrong decision, he himself adapt to that decision taken by him. So what is the speciality of a person to make that adaptable nature? So those kind of stuff we are going to discuss here. So little bit we are going to discuss about the biological aspect, but more on the algorithm and the computational aspect. First of all, let me introduce the term the fuzzy. I already told that whenever you provided with some kind of alternatives, you are in a position to choose one alternative, but you are fed up with some kind of confusion because all the alternatives that you are seeing seems to be good for you. So in that situation, you are facing some kind of confusion or some kind of uncertainty. That means the data or the object or the event provided to you have some kind of vagueness in it, so that you cannot decide on a particular decision. Likewise, if you take the real world situation, let me take in terms of information. The information is divided into two categories: measurement based information as well as perception based information. Say, for example, in terms of measurement based information, if someone is bringing some water in terms of some kind of hot water to you, means then the hotness of the water may be told in terms of numbers. It is 100 degrees Celsius. Suppose if any person is coming to meet you or discuss with you, that person age may be told in terms of measurement based information as 18. In case if you do not quantify the information, then the quantified value cannot be told, but by means of some experience, some how the quantified information is conveyed. So those kind of information is called perception based information. This perception based information is in turn divided into Boolean based information as well as linguistic based information. Let's just take the same example of the sentence, it is 100 degrees Celsius. This 100 degrees Celsius is a number, that is a numerical quantity. When you want to say in a Boolean form, you have to say whether it is hot or not. Likewise, if you have the name of a person, then you may say whether that name of the person is a girl or not. So those kind of things are Boolean based information. Coming to the next type, that is linguistic based information. Linguistic based information can be otherwise told by the term with the help of some kind of adjective word. It is hot, but to what level it is hot? Eva is a girl, but whether she is a young or middle-aged or very little. Likewise, you can say the term by adding some adjective into it. If you look at the word, it is very hot. Now, when some person is bringing a kind of tea or coffee to a group of people, one person may say that after tasting, it is very hot. But a neighboring person who is sitting nearing to you may say that, no, it is not so hot, I can take. But that person will say that you have a better experience of drinking tea or coffee in a hot manner. But I don't have that much experience. I usually take in a mild hot. And someone says that, no, I still want tea little bit mild level, below the mild level. Like that, they can share their experience when a hot tea or hot water is served to them. Look at the context. One person is saying that it is very hot. One person is saying that it is mild. One person is saying that, no, I want still below mild level of hotness. So, the objective term is whether it is hot or not. But it is varying to the person to person in a subjective form. So in most of the real world problem, these kind of statements are available. And these kinds of statements are unclear, uncertain, vague, and confused. Say, for example, we cannot quantify the term very hot. For someone, very hot means 100 degrees Celsius. For the person who is saying that I want mild, for him, very hot is more than 100 degrees Celsius. And for the person who is saying, I want below mild level, for him, the very hot means more than maybe 150 degrees Celsius or 200 degrees Celsius. So that means we cannot quantify the term, it is very hot. It means that these sentences have some kind of unclearness, uncertainty, or vague, or some kind of confusion. So these statements, unclear sentence, word, unclear, uncertain, vague, confused, are nothing but meaningful words when you look into the dictionary for the word fuzzy. So what is fuzzy? It is a normal English word which means unclear, uncertain, vague, and confused. So what is meant by fuzzy logic? It is a logic by means of which these kinds of unclear statement and these kinds of uncertain statement can be quantified so that the machine can understand the information very well. Because every machine is not subjective nature. Persons are subjective in nature, but the machines are subjective in nature. Machines are not subjective in nature. It is work with the numerical quantity presented to them. Whereas human can understand about the unclear statement once anyone is told to you. Say, for example, you are walking along the road to reach a particular point, and if you are saying that to how long from here to reach the destination, if you are asking a particular question to a roadsider, the roadsider may say that, no, it is very nearby. So you have a mindset that, okay, we came along from long distance, still it is very few miles so that we can walk or so that we can travel like that. But while traveling, you feel that still the destination place have not come. Now you are asking the neighboring person, on another roadsider, you are asking the distance, how much distance it is. Now the roadsider says, no, it is very far from here and probably it will take maybe 10 to 15 minutes. Now what do you think about it? The first person says that it is not so far, it is nearby. To him, the distance is very nearby. Maybe he will be usually using that road as his regular path. For the second person who is saying that it is very far, he is also a person like you, but he is very rat to this path and he says that it is very long. So that means the information given by any person according to a context may vary person to person. And that statement, not very far, it is very nearby, it is very long. So those kind of sentences are not quantified because they are not objective form and they are subjective form. So to quantify such information, that is some kind, that kind of unclear and uncertain, vague and confused information, which is treated as fuzzy information, we need certain logic so that these informations are quantified and then put into the computer. So most of our words that we use in our daily life are of this form, because every time when we talk to anyone regarding to a particular parameter, we always don't say measurement based information. We say only the quantified value of information. So most of the words in our daily life are not clearly defined. So to make those words as a cleared one, as a certained one, we need the idea of fuzzy logic. Now, participants, you may feel that, okay, so the concept of fuzzy is meant only for solving some kind of words, that is some kind of linguistic based words, to make a clear-cut statement. Certainly not. Because if you think so, then the concept of fuzzy logic will be applied only for sentence-based research, or it is meant for only text-based research, which is of the form linguistic-based information. Even though the concept of fuzzy logic is have been applied for such information, the first kind, the concept of fuzzy logic were introduced to clear the uncertain information available in the numerical data. So just now I say that the measurement based information is very quantifiable and it is very easier to solve. But there are certain situations in which this quantifiable information is also not possible to distinguish. Here, what is the variable given? Only the variable hot is given. That is hotness. The hotness is measured with the term degree Celsius and the quantified value is 100 degree Celsius. If only one variable is given, then there arises no need to use the concept of fuzzy logic if the numerical based information is used to solve a problem. Suppose for in a problem, if you have more than one variable and each variable contains numerical values and those values are overlapping with one another, then there arises a kind of confusion and vagueness even though it is a numerical data. In such a case, you definitely need the logic to mitigate the uncertainty present in the numerical data. So participants, I am saying, they say that uncertainty is not only presented in the sentence form, but also present in the numerical values. Let me explain this in one more slide. So to solve this uncertainty, who is most experienced one and how he is good at to solve this kind of uncertainty? Because someone says that it is not very far, it is nearby only. No, it is very far, but not that much effort that you have to put. So he is very young. He is not that much young, but seems to be looking old. If that information is told to you, your concept, that means you can infer those sentences by quantifying those sentences into some numerical values. You may assume that if it is not that much far, means you may say that it is some 3 kilometer distance or 1 kilometer distance. If he is not so young but seems to be middle-aged, in that case you may say that person age may be around 30. Like that, you can take or you can quantify on your own. So who is good at that kind of task? It is human. How he is good at those kind of tasks? Because he has a common sense to reason in a world. So what organ is used to do this common sense? Again, it is human brain. Participant, for the past 3 days, we have discussed about the artificial neural network. It is nothing but imitating the structure as well as functioning of the new brain. So this as concept of fuzzology, here also the operations of human brain is came into picture. So this is not exactly the biological operation that is carried out in the brain, but it is the sense that is performed by the human brain, because our human brain can reason with the vague assertion and can claim that involve uncertainties, even though if it is a sentence form or even though it is a numerical form. Why not computer? As said in the initial presentation of the first day, machine learning, humans are good at pattern recognition, whereas machines are good at processing the numerical information. Likewise, humans are good at reasoning, whereas machines are good at processing only the numerical information. But just now I told that even though computer is good at numerical information, still the vagueness, uncertainty, or some kind of fuzziness is associated in the numerical information also. If it is single variable data, then you can alleviate the problem of uncertainty. Suppose if the problem contains more than one variable, then certainly the problem of uncertainty is there because of the overlapping nature of the variable. To solve such overlapping nature of the variable, you need a logic. Apart from the some kind of logic, you need a specific logic, and that logic is fuzzy logic. So let me explain it with the help of one more illustration, how the uncertainty is involved in the numerical data. Let me take an example. I want to make a machine, or I want to create an expert system. That system, without the help of a human being, has to classify the flower automatically. Imagine I have a system. That system has a belt. So in the belt, I am pouring the flower, which contains these three categories clubbed together. So once the flower entered into the core part of the machine, my machine has a certain blade. That blade will categorize the flower automatically into jasmine, rotena, and peachy. So by perception, if you look at these three flowers, by perception, these three flowers look one and the same. But machine has to do this task automatically. As a human being, you can easily categorize these flowers when these flowers are clubbed together. Imagine a situation in a small bag, these three flowers, maybe 100 grams of each flower, are put together, mixed together, and given to you so that you are in a position to segregate the flower according to its category. So as a human being, you can do it well because you have an eye. With the help of your eyesight, you can easily see the texture of that flower, and you can classify. As well as you have a nose, by the smell of the flower, you can categorize the flower. Think about what about the machine. You may say about we can go for image processing, or we can go for some kind of sensors to classify the flower. But still, those informations are alone not sufficient for the machine to do. The machine also needs some kind of numerical information apart from those image features as well as the sensor related information. So let me take that information from flowers for automatic classification by a expert system. Let me take the measurement as sepal length, sepal width, petal length, petal width. Participants, I think you remember these four parameters we have discussed in the earlier class of artificial neural network in the MATLAB implementation. So let me take these four information for these kind of flowers, jasmine, rotena, and the peach. So these measurements are not unique for each flower. It may vary from their predefined ranges of values. Say, for example, sepal length varies from 1 to 3. Sepal width ranges from 0.3 to 0.7. Petal length may vary from 2 to 6. Petal width may vary from 1 to 2. For a jasmine flower, the sepal length is not 2.3 always. For a rotena flower, the sepal length may not be 2.5 always. For a pitchy flower, the sepal length may not be 1.1 always. If that information is fixed, that is 2.3 is the fixed sepal length for all the flowers of jasmine. 2.5 is the fixed sepal length for all the flowers of rotena. 1.5 is the fixed sepal length for all the flowers of pitchy. Then you need not have any confusion, then the information is very clear to you, so that the machine can also automatically perform the task of classification of the flower. But what is really there, the sepal length is not a fixed one. It is a varying one between the range 1 to 3. So one jasmine flower, if you take from the bunch of jasmine flower, it may measure up to 1.1 for sepal length. Maybe for another jasmine flower, it may be 1.5. Maybe for another jasmine flower, it may be for 3. For another jasmine flower, it may be for 1.1. What is I am trying to convey to you is, if the sepal length for a particular flower is a varying one. So if you mix another category of flower into that particular flower, it is also varying from the same predefined range. So if you add category another flower, then also it is also found that it is varying from the range. So if you club all these three flowers, then even though you are in a position to categorize the flower automatically, but the machine does not categorize the flower automatically, because if you take the flower of size 2.5, then it may have a confusion that whether it is jasmine or whether it is pitchy, because all the three kinds of flowers, the ranges of sepal length is varied between 1 to 3. That means some kind of overlapping is there. Suppose, say for example, sepal length of jasmine is 1 to 3. Sepal length of rotena is 5 to 7. Sepal length of pitchy is 8 to 10. See, here the range is very distinct in nature and it is individual for individual flower. In that case, there is no overlapping. That means there is no confusion. And you, not only you, but also machine can automatically perform the task of classification without need of any logic. But what is the situation here? The sepal length range is 1 to 3. And this sepal length range is common across all the flowers. Not only sepal length. Look at the other measurement also. Sepal width, petal width, and petal width. And all these measurements are varied over a range for these categories of flowers. So that, what do you infer from this kind of situation? A lot of uncertainties or a lot of confusion is there to decide upon the flower based on by a machine. So for these cases, you need a logic, and that logic should work out to have a quantified information so that the machine can do the task of classification of flower automatically without any confusion. So that's the purpose of fuzzy logic. So how to make a computer to reason for make decision about the uncertainties present in the numerical data? That is, I explained in the previous slide, how to make a computer. We have to make a computer to reason or to make decision about the uncertainty. What kind of uncertainty is there? The sepal length is overlapping with one another. Not only sepal length, other measurements are also overlapping with one another for each category of flower. So those uncertainties has to be quantified to a particular degree of value so that the computer can easily categorize or classify the flower according to its type. So how to make the computer? You need three kinds to make the computer to do the task of automatic classification of flower without any error. That is, like a human being, like an expert system, yes, the computer will do the task of classification of the flower. What are the three things required? One is logic, another one is set, another one is inference. If these three things are developed as a code, and that code is embedded into the chip, and if that chip is embedded into a system, then the system will do the task of automatic classification of flower, even though the flower data have some uncertainties or more uncertainties present in them. So what is the purpose of each thing? First, let me take the first one, logic. So logic, the logic is used to describe the unclear statement. What is the unclear statement? The sepal length is like this, or the sentence is like that, very young and very old. Those kind of unclear statement or those kind of unclear data can be easily described with the help of logic. Let me explain the further slide. Next, what is required? Set. What is the purpose of set? Once the unclear statement is described, it has to be calibrated into a clear one. So to calibrate, we need set. Then, What is the third one? It is inference. What is the use of this inference? This inference is used to make a definite conclusion. That is, the inference is a certain set of procedures that is carried out to make a decision about the uncertain data. So these three things are required to take a decision. One is logic, another one is set, another one is inference. In every term, you just prefix the word fuzzy. Since the concept is going to deal with fuzzy kind of data. What is fuzzy? Fuzzy is a literal English word which means unclear, vague, uncertain, or something called confusion. So just literally add the word fuzzy in front of each word, then you came to know that the idea behind the concept of fuzzy logic to design an expert system for taking an effective decision with the respective uncertainty data. So fuzzy logic, fuzzy set, as the fuzzy inference. That's what we are going to deal in this particular presentation. If you put all these together and if you create a system, that system is nothing but expert system. Since that expert system is built with the help of fuzzy logic, fuzzy set, and fuzzy inference, the system is called fuzzy expert system. That's what the objective of today's presentation. So until now, participants, I have given only the backgrounds. So now we are going to enter into the concept. First one, first logic. So what is this? So you know logic gates, right? So from the gate, logic gates, what are the two types of information available? 0 and 1. So it was introduced by Aristotle and it is called that bivalent logic. So at any point of time, you have only two values, either 0 or 1. 0 means it is in off condition. 1 means it is in on condition. So those kind of logical gates are very well utilized in the concept of digital principles as well as computer architecture and many other hardware design. So in those days, the Aristotle's bivalent logic is used for designing or developing any machine model. So it always accepts either 0 value or 1 value to make an autonomous decision. So those decisions are treated as very sharp decision and it doesn't have any flexibility or adaptability in it. Later in the period 1965, this concept, that is, whenever some situation, some kind of uncertain situation arises, at that situation, we need to take certain kind of decision that may not be a 0 or may not be a 1, but in between 0 and 1. Those kind of concept is required. And it was found out by a professor, Lofty Jada, in the year 1965. And he named the idea, that is a logic, as fuzzy logic. And this fuzzy logic will work in respect of human being. And it is always taking a decision in a smoother manner so that the system will work autonomously based on the environment without taking any abrupt decision of closing or opening the system. So that is the idea behind logic. So if you look at the picture here, so the concept of Boolean logic or bivalent logic is a two-valued system where in which you have 0 at one part, immediately the value 0 is transferred to 1. There is a sharp transition from 0 to 1. Whereas this fuzzy logic is having the value of 0 and 1 and it is treated as multi-valued logic. So this multi-valued logic is taking a value between 0 and 1 and the transition between 0 and 1 is not abrupt or it is not very sharp, but rather it is very gradual. That means it is gradually going from 0 value to 1. So that is the idea here. So once the concept of this fuzzy logic was introduced, it is given the name multi-valued logic, but it is the marketing name introduced by the Professor Lofty Jada, the term fuzzy associated with the word, to say that this concept is widely used for the kind of uncertainty involved in the data. That is, you look at the first point for dealing with imprecise data. The data itself, it's not a precise one. It is imprecise. So that's the idea here. So you want to understand fuzzy logic further, you can, I will give some references in the last part of the presentation. You can go further. Since for the time limitation, I limit the idea of fuzzy logic with this first slide. Next comes to set. So what is set? So here we are talking about both the classical set theory, that is mathematical set theory, as well as fuzzy set theory. The left part of the presentation discusses about the mathematical set theory. The right part discusses about the fuzzy set theory. Come to the left part first. So I want to categorize a set of person whose height is greater than 6. That is, I want to represent the person in the form of set. Look at it here. Tall person is equal to height of the person such that height should be greater than 6. If you want to represent in the set form, then how it is represent the set form? A equal to x such that x equal greater than 6. If I want to represent in the form of Venn diagram, see above is a Venn diagram, then this is universe of discourse which contains that rectangular box is a universe of discourse which contains heights of every person. Whereas this one is the set A which comprises of only the person whose height is greater than 6. That means a tall person. So this is a class way in which we have quantify the tall persons with some other categories of person in terms of the values. So if you look at this kind of set theory, you can find that the boundary is very clear. See, the boundary is very clear and it is very unambiguous. There is no confusion in it. There's no confusion in it. So you always say that it is a set with crisp and a sharp boundary. Let me take the situation of the fuzzy set theory. There are some situations. If you want a machine to work like a human being, then your machine to take a decision not sharply, but rather than some kind of flexibility has to be there in terms of using the concept of fuzzy logic. So in such cases, you are introducing the fuzzy set theory as set A equal to set of person X such that each person should be associated with some degrees of value, and that degrees of values is represented by new A of X such that X greater than 6. So please notify the difference between A here in terms of mathematical set theory, A here in terms of fuzzy set theory. What is absent here and what is present here? The term new A of X. What is this new A of X? Even though the person X doesn't belong to a tall category, to what level can we make that person into a tall category? Even though the person belongs to a tall category, to what confident that person belongs to a tall category? So those level is a term or is told by means of a degrees of values, and these degrees of value is represented by the term new A of X. New A is the term which is popularly called in the context of fuzzy set. Sorry, something has not visible here. Let me go back. Yeah, yes. So here, you can find that set A equal to X. Why X? Now, in this mathematical set, when you represent A equal to within the parenthesis X, this X is normal set. But here, this X is set as fuzzy set. Why this X is set as fuzzy set? Because it is not a singular. It is associated with another value, mu A of X. If this mu A of X is associated with this value, then it is called as fuzzy set. And this mu A of X is nothing but degree of values, and it is represented by a concept called membership function. So, like activation function, which is more important in terms of artificial neural network, here in fuzzy set theory, what is important? Membership function is more important because it is the one which quantifies the confused value by means of some degrees of value. Say, for example, look at this figure. In terms of grist set theory, the height 5 feet 10 inch is treated as a not tall person. Whenever the height increases above this value by 0.001 inch, definitely he entered into the category of tall. That is, your machine is always crisp and sharp in taking a decision. Whereas a human being are not like that. So if you look at the operation of brain, the human being will always have adaptability in nature, and they always have some kind of flexibility in nature to have concern about the individual or to have concern about the incident. So those kind of stuff is characterized by membership function, where which if you plot the graph for such kind of situation, see, when this graph is showing a smooth transition from the non-height person, non-tall person to tall person. So everywhere you can quantify the degrees of value. So the 5 feet 10 inch person, even though he is not belonging to a tall person category, I can quantify that. So with the value of 0.5. So with the value of 0.5, that is with the 50%, we can say that this person belongs to tall category. So for rest of the category, he may not be at all. Likewise, look at the person whose height is 6 inch 2 feet. With the help of membership function, how can I decode the membership value? So I have to take this value from x-axis to the membership curve. Then corresponding in the y-axis, I have to take the value. If I take the y-axis value, that the y-axis value is 0.9. So you please, participant, remember that the y-axis is always 0 to 1. Since it is a degrees of values, it represents the probabilistic value. So it is always 0 to 1. So here, for the person whose height is 6 feet 2 inch, the decoded value for that person is, that is the degree of value for this person is 0.9. That means the person whose height is 16 2 feet is definitely a tall person. Whereas the 5 feet 10 inch person may be a tall person or may not be a tall person, subjective to the person with the degree of value 0.5, that is 50%. So likewise, you need to decode any data with respect to fuzzy set theory. So any data is given to you. That means if you come across any variable and whose values are given as a numerical form, for each numerical value, you have to associate a degree of value. The degree of values are ranges between 0 to 1 to quantify such value with respect to another variable, so that some kind of confusion is avoided while making the decision. So logic is over, set is over, and the third part is inference. So what is inference? It is the computing framework. That is, this is the heart of the fuzzy expert system, using which you are going to design, you are going to make decision. And this heart of the fuzzy expert system consists of three subcomponents: database, rule base, and inference engine. So schematically, if I am talking about this model, database and rule base are treated as knowledge base, and inference engine is treated as a separate one, as in a separate block. So these two blocks work concurrently together to produce the output. So these three things, database, rule base, and inference engine, for better understanding, you have to better understand the idea of fuzzy set theory, fuzzy if-then rule, and the concept of fuzzy reasoning. Remember the concept of fuzzy reasoning. Fuzzy reasoning is the most and most important concept by means of which only the entire fuzzy system is working. So what way the human is taking reasoning to come to a conclusion, the same way the concept of fuzzy is introduced to make a reasoning process. I am not going to deal this fuzzy reasoning in depth because it involves many mathematical ideas. If you are interested to understand further into the concept of fuzzy reasoning, I may please be contacted personally so that I can teach you this kind of stuff. So for the time limitation, I skip this part in to explain in depth, and I will go to further presentation, further part of the slide. So once again, I remind you, there are three components that are required: database, rule base, those are treated as knowledge base, and the inference engine. So in inference engine, that is take this reasoning mechanism, you have three different models are available: Mamdani model, Takaki, Sujino Kong model, and Sugata model. These three models, some inference procedure is already built. Those inbuilt model can be plugged into your problem for taking an effective decision based on the data that you have. For each and every model has its own operation, has its own mathematical equation. Again, I am also not going to touch in depth about that model. If you want, I can teach in some other kind of sessions or some other kind of personal discussion if you want. So these kind of models are can be utilized as a inference engine. Either you can go with the Mamdani model as an inference engine, or Takaki Sugino model as an inference engine, or Sugimoto model for inference engine to make a definite conclusion. That means to a reasoning mechanism. What the common in all the three models are, three steps are common in all the three models. What are those steps? Apply fuzzy operator, apply implication method, aggregate all the outputs. Again, these three operations are common are in need of some strong mathematical background. I'm also not going to touch those aspects. If I touch those aspects, again, it is be a time-consuming process. So with the time constraint, I limit this idea. So what is the duty of inference engine? The duty of inference engine to make reasoning, that is to make a definite conclusion by accepting the input data. So how many inference engines are available? Three inference engines are available: Mamdani, ESK, Sugimoto. What are the common operations performed in each of the inference engine? Application of fuzzy operator, application of implication method, and aggregation of outputs. So this thing is required as of now to understand the fundamentals of the concept of designing a fuzzy expert system. So let me explain the database as well as the rule base further in the next subsequent slide. So what is database? Database is a collection of membership function. I already explained very detailed about the concept of membership function in the previous slides. That is, a membership function is a curve. This curve defines how each point of a input variable is mapped to a corresponding membership value, that is in the y-axis. If you give x-axis, this is nothing but the variable's actual value. If you look at the y-axis, it is nothing but the variable's membership value. Look at the same scenario of identifying the tall person. The value tall is used in the x-axis, and corresponding membership value is decoded from the y-axis. So the same scenario I explained in depth in the previous slides. I think you understand the slide and what I am going to convey. So let me go into the next part. So commonly used membership function. So these are all the common form of membership function that can be used for quantifying the values of any variable: triangular, trapezoidal, Gaussian, and generalization. And for each membership function, they are associated a mathematical notation, that is mathematical equations. Here, if you look at it, that x is the original value of the variable. Say, for example, it is hot. That means it is 100 degrees Celsius. That 100 is the value of x. Likewise, sepal length, it is 2.3. That value 2.3 is given here. So once the 2.3 is given here, and with respect to other parameters, the quantified value is taken with respect to trim MF function. Likewise, for trap MF, Gaussian MF, and G-Bell MF. So these are all the commonly used membership function. And there are other membership functions are also available that I can tell you, say you in the afternoon practical class. So what is the duty in the database? It is the duty to collect the membership function required for your data or for the variables present in the data. Next, rule base. What is the rule base? So the rule base is conditional statement. Rule base are nothing but some kind of conditional statement which is of the form: if certain action, certain event, then certain action. If x is A, then y is B. So that is the general form of any fuzzy rule. In that, the first part, x is A, is called by the name antecedent or premise. Then y is B is called as consequence or conclusion. So while you are going to design an expert system, you should generate such kind of conditional statement and make ready these conditional statement as a rule base, and it has to be worked along with the database. That database along with the rule base has to be fed into the inference engine, then that inference engine will make a definite conclusion. So how to generate this rule base is itself a research problem. So I am not going to touch that research problem. It is a very big one. For better understanding, let us look at the general form as well as a general example. So what is the example says? That if pressure is high, then volume is small. If road is slippery, then driving is dangerous. Likewise, you have to derive or you have to devise rules for your data or for the variables present in your data. So once these kind of conditional statement have been made ready, then it is said that the construction of rule base is ready. So what is ready now? It is the database is ready and rule base is ready, and these two is combined together to create a knowledge base, and this knowledge base plays a vital role for the expert system to execute its own process so that it can take autonomous decision without the intervention of human beings. Let me come to the core part of the presentation, that is fuzzy expert system. So these are all the many components of fuzzy expert system. How many components are there? There are four components are there in the fuzzy system: fuzzifier, inference engine, defuzzifier, fuzzy knowledge base. Fuzzy knowledge base are nothing but the collection of database as well as the rule base that I have explained just now. And the inference engine is the one which is used to take decision. So based on the inference model, either Mamdani, TSK or Sugimoto, it is taking the decision by accepting the input from the fuzzifier block. So finally, how the output is produced? With the help of the defuzzifier block, about output is produced. So participants, until now I explained the three ideas in inference engine, database as well as the rule base. These three in the concepts needs the concept of logic, as well as that is fuzzy logic, as well as the concept of the theory. So these three things put together to form the core part of the expert system that is available as inbuilt, or you have to do on your own. Strictly speaking, inference engine is ready-madely available. You can just plug and play the ready-madely available inference engine. But very strictly speaking, the fuzzy knowledge base is the one which creates many headaches for you to design the expert system. To generate the fuzzy knowledge base, that is the database, also the rule base, there are some other approaches are available. There are many papers dealing with this. Of course, that is the core part of my research work in the master as well as the PhD. How to generate fuzzy knowledge base from the data to design a fuzzy expert system. So that is not part of our presentation. So as usual, I keep the idea of generating the fuzzy rule base as well as fuzzy database. But for designing purpose, I will give the rule base as well as database so that the database and rule base can be used in the afternoon practical class for designing the expert system. So what are the two blocks that left unexplained in this presentation? One is fuzzifier block and defuzzifier block. Let me explain the fuzzifier block first. So what is the duty of the fuzzifier block? It accepts the input. As the picture says that, it accepts the input. What is the duty of the defuzzifier block? It produces the output. So let me explain the fuzzifier block first. Once the input is given to the fuzzifier block, what's the duty performed by the fuzzifier block is fuzzification of the input. What is meant by fuzzification? The task of transforming a variable in the form of GRISP set to a fuzzy set is called fuzzification. What is GRISP set and fuzzy set? When I explained in the previous slide, if a variable tall is given to you, then that variable is associated with the membership value, then it is treated as fuzzy set. So simply speaking, if the variable tall, then it is GRISP set. If you add a fuzzy set, that means if you add a mu a of x associated with the tall, then it is a fuzzy set. So what you have to do first, you have to divide the given variable into so many linguistic variables. Then you have to assign each linguistic variable a membership function. Let me give an example for that. So let me take an example of age. So age is a variable. Now, this age variable has to be partitioned into so many linguistic variables. In what way I can divide the age variable into linguistic variable? Look at the example. These many linguistics are possible. Not only these, I have added some dot dot symbol. That means etc. That is, the age variable can be categorized or can be partitioned into so many linguistic variables like young, not young, not very young, etc. Like middle age, not middle age, etc. Not old, not old, very old. Likewise, you can divide the variable into so many linguistics. For simplicity, in this slide, the variable age is divided into three linguistics: young, middle age, and old. And for after partitioning the variable age into linguistic, then it is the duty to assign membership function to each linguistic variable. See here in this slide, look at the figure. So the young is associated with half trapezoidal membership function. Middle aged is associated with full trapezoidal membership function. Old is associated with half trapezoidal membership function. Look at the overlapping scenario in this picture. See, when I take the age, whose range is 0 to 90? You look at the x-axis. The variable age, x, is taking the range 0 to 90. That means I am collecting a data. Say that data contains age of many persons and whose ages are varying between 0 to 90. Now, I want to apply fuzzy over that variable. If I want to apply the concept of fuzzy over the variable, I have to partition the variable into as many as linguistic as possible. For simplicity, here, three linguistics are divided. One is young, another one is middle age, another one is old. After dividing the linguistic variable into linguistic, then you have to define the range for the linguistic. So the range may be for young, see where it starts from zero, where it ends something up here, in the mid of 40 to 50. So I can say that the young starts from zero and ends at 45. And where middle age starts, the middle age starts at the value 10 and it ends at, say for example, something closer to 80. Say maybe I can take as 75. What is the case of old? It starts at the value maybe, see here, something between 30 and 40, maybe 35, and it ends at 90. So when one can say a person is young, if his age is from 0 to 45, then I can say that person is young. Accordingly, what is the confusion here? I can say a person whose age starts at 20 and that at 70, I can say that person is middle age. Likewise, old, when the person starts more than 40, definitely I can say that person is old. So likewise, I have to design the pacifier block. So now, what is the confusion here? Look at the space between 20 to 40. Now, if I say that, say for example, my age is 38, where my age falls between 30 to 40. So in that case, I can be treated as a young person, as well as I am also treated as a middle-aged person. To what level I may be treated as a young person? Say for example, my age is 38 here. Look at the x-axis, 38, look at my arrow. So 38 is here. If I take this 38 and make my 38 to cut in the young curve, that is yellow line, so it is cut here. So correspondingly, I can take the y-axis value. What is the y-axis value? It is 0.2. So for the 20, so if I group here 100% in your group, and I ask the 100% to say my age, that means 20% of the group say that I am young person. But if I extend the 38 from x-axis to further, it is cut in the middle-aged category. So where it is cut? It is cut almost one. If you parallelly take the vertex axis, it is cutting almost one. That means almost all the people will say, I am a middle-aged person. But still, there arises a confusion how to decide the category when there is a overlap. So this situation, I am saying that overlap. So 20 to 40 is treated as the overlap value, that is either young or middle age. Likewise, look at it here, the value 50 to 80 is treated as either middle age or old. So those kind of overlapped value is quantified by membership grade or degrees of membership values with the value of 0 to 1. So that is the duty of the block, pacifier block. Next, depacifier block. Depacifier block, you don't need to worry about it because some standard models are available, like centroid of area, bisector of area, mean of maximum, smallest of maximum, largest of maximum, some kinds of methods are available. Using those methods, you can convert the fuzzy value into crisp value. Look at the picture here. You know, at this point, it is giving some kind of confusion what this picture is about. You remember the last operation of the inference engine. What is the last operation of the inference engine? There are three operations I said. One is apply fuzzy operator, apply implication method. Last operation is apply aggregate method. So this is the output of aggregate method of inference engine. Over the aggregated output, the concept of deep classifier block is applied with respect to any one of the available deep classifier strategy. So if you apply these deep classifier strategy, the corresponding output is produced. Say for example, if I use centroid of area, then this value is taken. That is, along the z axis, this value is taken. If I apply smallest of maximum, then this value is taken. If I apply mean of maximum, then this value is taken. Likewise, you have to decode from the aggregated output. That is the duty of deep classifier block. And you need not worry about it. There are some methods are available to do those tasks. So I think you understand all the blocks of classifier component. What I can do here is I will stop my presentation here. I will explain further with the case study as well as the practical illustration in the afternoon session. I hope you understand the idea behind the fuzzy logic. Let me stop the presentation for a while and I go for some kind of question from the participants. Participants, if you have any question, you can ask. I will resume with the presentation with respect to case study as well as the practical in the afternoon session. Until now, I have covered a few things to understand the concept of fuzzy logic and how to design a fuzzy expert system. If you have any doubts to ask, you please raise your hands so that I can unmute and we will talk together. Is there any question? So if you do not have any question, yes, Ravindra Yoga. Yes, sir. Unmute yourself. Yes, Ravindra. Yes, Mr. Ravindra.
Yes, sir. Ravindra.
Yeah, yes. Tell me, sir.
So my question is not related for today's presentation. Yes. It was related for the yesterday's session. Convolution neural network and the convolution fully connected layer, ReLU and all that.
Yes.
So my research work is going on leaf disease identification.
Okay.
And I asked the question day before of the presentation also.
Yes, you can proceed. Whatever the session, even first day session question also you can ask. No problem.
Okay. So my question is how the feature extraction can be done for the image processing and which is important feature from where we can easily get the accurate result at the last layer.
See, normally research and all trial and error approach, you cannot go exactly to the point where it suits well for your problem. You start with some available feature extraction technique. You apply those available feature extraction techniques. Or I can say that there are some research article that dealt with this works good for the problem. So if your problem also similar to that problem, you just mimic or you just imitate the feature extraction techniques that is discussed in that article into your problem. And then you decide design the classifier model. You look into the classification accuracy that you obtained. If you are satisfied with the result, you go ahead. Otherwise, you look for some other kind of feature extraction techniques. But as far as my yesterday presentation is concerned, if you look into it clearly, with respect to pattern recognition task, that is image processing task, if you use normal neural network model, you should do feature extraction task separately. Whereas if you use CNN, no need to worry about the separate feature extraction task. The concept of convolution as well as the concept of pooling operation is doing the activity of feature extraction. So only thing you need to think about is how to increase the size of the stride, how to perform the padding, and how to increase the future map size so that I can so that you can get the better accuracy at the last layer, that is fully connected layer as well as the classification layer. So in such way, you have to think about your problem. So it is totally a trial and error approach. You may not slightly go to the one which perfectly suits to your problem. So you start with some model. That means somebody else have claimed that this model worked out well. So you correlate your problem strategy with their problem strategy. If both the problems look similar, you just proceed with their idea implemented in your case. If it comes out well, then you proceed. If not comes out well, you just go through the data that you have. So depending on the characteristics of the data, you look into the literature further. So in the literature, they say about something. If the data characteristics is like that, you have to choose this model. If the data characteristics is like that, you have to choose this model. So accordingly, you can choose the model. So it is up to you to explore, finally come to a particular point for implementation and taking the result, right? I hope you understand. Hello? So there is no one method is claimed as the effective method. So all research methods are of greedy nature. So what you can do is just utilize or just use the existing method that depends on the characteristics of the data and the problem that you have in your hand. Apply it, take the results, and based on the obtained results, you remodify your decision by taking another method or choosing another kind of idea like that, and you can go on. So is there any other question? So if so if no question is there, I think we stop the session now, and we will resume back. Organizer, is there any information for the participant with this?
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. The session went very informative and excellent session, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you all the participants for excellent participation. Thank you, sir. Afternoon session will be started on 2:30 p.m., sir.
Okay, sir. Okay, sir.
Okay, sir.
Okay,
thank you very much, sir.
Okay, participants and organizer, see you at 2:30. Thank you. Thank you for your patient listening.
Okay, thank you, sir.